him. I said, Mr. Ambassador, who had the greatest effect on your life? Before I could get the question out, he said, Dr. Mays. I said, Benjamin Mays at Morehouse College? I just knew he was going to say Dr. King. He said, yeah, Dr. Mays at Morehouse College. I said, why Benjamin Mays? He said, because you could always tell when a student was taking a class from Benjamin Mays at Morehouse. I said, what do you mean, Mr. Ambassador? He said, you could see him running across the quad. You see, Benjamin Mays at Morehouse only had two rules in his classroom, students. Rule number one, he would always correct your English. And the juniors and seniors would get up, man, that's whack. Why is this guy correcting my English? And Dr. Mays would reply, would you rather have me correct your English or a prospective employer correct your English? And rule number two, Benjamin Mays said, I'll always be the last one in class. See, he didn't care on the syllabus, in the roll book, in the catalog, class was due to start at 1 o'clock. He got there at 12:45, that door was closed. You see, on time is late, and early is on time, and late, well, late is fired. And he made every student, under his charge, under his command, memorize that old poem. Of only just a minute, 60 seconds in it, forced upon it, can't refuse it, didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but I know that I must use it, I will suffer if I lose it, pay account if I abuse it, just a tiny little minute, but baby, your life is in it. Point number two. Point number two, you commit yourself to excellence. You don't be average. I remember when Lou Holtz, the head football coach at Notre Dame, brought me in to speak to his team. He said, average is best of the worst, worst of the best, top of the bottom, bottom of the top. You see, we have a dress code in Clark Atlanta, the School of Business. We tell the students, listen, you got a blue shirt, CAU School of Business, or an Oxford shirt, you can wear any shirt you want as long as it's white or blue. Now, why is that critically important? Because you never know who's looking. You never know who's looking. As Maynard Jackson, former mayor of Atlanta, said, you look the part, act the part, walk the part, talk the part, think the part. Well, baby, guess what? You get the part. That part was driven home 2 years ago. You listen to me, Spartans. There I am in my class looking at that sea of black faces, and guess who comes in my classroom completely and totally unannounced and sits in the back? Randall Pinkett, the apprentice. And when I saw Dr. Pinkett, listen, 5 degrees. Madam President, you got a PhD in what, nuclear physics from MIT? He comes in my classroom, sits in the back, and when I recognize him, I said, Dr. Pinkett, hey, I'm sitting down. You're teaching class today. Tell my students something they need to know. And he stood in the pit, the same pit that I stand in every Tuesday and Thursday, and he said, students, whatever you do, don't shoot for top of the mountain, shoot for the stars. And I said, Dr. Pinkett, please translate. He said, well, if you shoot for the top of the mountain and you fall at the base of the mountain. But baby, if you shoot for the stars and you fall at the top of the mountain. And I remember when I interviewed Kwame Jackson. Kwame Jackson, runner-up to The Apprentice. And I interviewed him in New Orleans, undergrad, UNC Chapel, Harvard MBA. And I said to him, I said, Kwame, what was it like? I said, I sat in on classes and I've had presentations at Harvard B School, but I never attended a class at Harvard B School. What was it like pursuing your MBA at Harvard? And he said, Doc, I remember it as if it were yesterday. Sunday before classes started, they brought the entire class together, had a dinner for us. Some professors were there to distribute the first case, and they divided us up into cohorts. The next day, Monday morning, the first time I ever walked down the hall at Harvard Business School, some professor, he didn't know me and I didn't know him, and he got up in my face and he pointed his finger at me, and he said, young man, you got the rest of your life to be average. But the next 2 years you're here at Harvard, I suggest that you pursue excellence. And so on one side I got Randall Pinkett, on the other side I got Kwame Jackson. We're talking about a commitment to excellence, Spartans. You see, mediocrity is not the standard at this school. You can be mediocre at any of the other 104 HBCUs. Mediocrity is not the standard at Norfolk State. Yes. You can be mediocre any place you want, but you can't be mediocre here. And so I said to him, I said, what did you learn from the billionaire Donald Trump? What did Donald Trump, the billionaire, teach you? I said, Randall, you were with Trump for a year and a half. Kwame, you were with him for 6 months. And almost in unison, they said, if we learn anything from the billionaire Donald Trump, says, commit yourself to excellence. He said, take on any challenge, overcome any obstacle, do whatever you got to do, but be the best. And when you become the best, don't keep it a secret. Tell the world about it. Why? Because there's no limit what people will pay for the best. No one wants second best. They only want the best. And last but not least, number three, students, before I end this little feeble message, number three, you better believe in yourself when no one else will. Oh, yeah. You better believe in yourself when no one else will. I want you to be like Sammy. Sammy is 8 years old in the third grade, painting a picture at his desk, and the teacher comes by and says, Sammy, what are you doing? Sammy says, I'm painting a picture of God. Teacher says, well, no one knows what God looks like. Sammy says, they will in a minute. You believe in yourself. Now, who in the world taught me that? One of the last interviews I had. I went to Hattiesburg, Mississippi, class of 2013, and I sat at the feet of a little woman, little black washerwoman, never heard a fly in her life, by the name of Osceola McCarty. She took in the wash of everybody in Hattiesburg, Mississippi, and everybody laughed at this little old washerwoman. After nearly 80 years of work, she saved every dime that came by her hand, and she amassed a fortune in excess of $250,000. Well, she gets a phone call from a banker one day, and a banker says, Ms. McCarty, as a senior level VP at this bank, I'm obligated to ask you the following question. He says, listen, it's no secret you do have a sizable investment in our institution. But sweetheart, you are getting up in years. The question begs asking, what do you want done with your resources and the untimely nature of your debt? And she says, sir, that's not a problem. I've been thinking about that. He said, you have to, yeah. I want you to take the first $100,000 and give it to my church. And take the remainder, $150,000, give it to worthy and deserving black college students at this school. He said, what school? She said, the school right here in town. He said, you mean to tell me the University of Southern Mississippi? She said, yes, sir. A school she was barred from attending because of her race. And the 4 hours that I sat with her, she sat in her rocking chair, rocking back and forth, holding that old beat up, tattered, covered Bible, scotch tape to keep Corinthians from falling out. In class of 2013, I sat at her feet taking notes with both hands. I said, Miss McCarty, I must have the answer. What is greatness? What is success? She said, young man, do as much as you can for all that you can. Students, you get a big dream, you commit yourself to excellence, you don't be average, and you believe in yourself when somebody else will. So what makes the great great? I asked Jeanetta Cole when she was president of Spelman College. She said, show me somebody content with mediocrity, and I'll show you somebody destined to fail. What makes the great, great students? I asked Bob Johnson, founder of BET Television. He says, life is a grindstone. Whether it grinds you down or polishes you up depends on what you were made of. What makes the great, great? I interviewed Mae Jemison, first black woman in outer space. I said, my God, Dr. Jemison, a physician and an astronaut too? When did you get this idea? She said, I knew exactly what I want to be since age 8. I said, well, please give me the answer. She said, you can find it in the word lifestyle. Life is God's gift to you. Style is what you do with it. What makes the great great? I asked T.D. Jakes, the bishop himself. I said, Bishop Jakes, there I am, one-on-one with Bishop T.D. Jakes in his book line study. And there we are, I'm looking at every book on God's green earth that you would ever want to read, examine, or study in your lifetime. And I said, Bishop, I'm not getting on that plane and flying back Atlanta to Atlanta until you give me the answer to greatness and success. He said, you can run out of time, you can run out of family, you can run out of money, you can run out of resources, and you can run out of friends. But don't you ever run out of God. What makes the great, great? I'm going to take my seat. I didn't interview him once. I interviewed him twice. Ben Carson, arguably the greatest neurosurgeon on the face of this planet. And I said, Dr. Carson, if you think